Windows PowerShell is probably best known for being a command line tool that you can use to manage Windows. After all, PowerShell has a number of commands that provide very deep integration into the Windows operating system. So, with a couple of minor exceptions, anything that you can do from the GUI can also be done through PowerShell. And PowerShell allows you to manage Windows at scale. However, you can also leverage that deep integration with the Windows operating system for other purposes. As an example, you could build a self-service user portal. In just about any organization, there are certain problems that come up over and over again. And oftentimes, those problems result in the user making a call to the help desk. But what if you could keep the user from having to call the help desk? What if you could automate the solution to those problems that the user is having? And what if you knew which problems occur most often in your organization and came up with automated solutions to those problems? Well, you can do exactly that through PowerShell. And to show you how this works, I've created a self-service portal. Now, the self-service portal is only intended to be used as a proof of concept. If you want to use this in your own organization, you're going to have to adapt the code to your own organization's infrastructure. But let's take a look at how this works. So I've created a PowerShell script called portal.ps1. I'm going to go ahead and run that script. And here's what my self-service portal looks like. And once again, this is just a proof of concept. If you have certain problems that come up over and over in your organization, you can build an automated solution to those problems and add those to the dashboard that I've created. You could even replace some of the buttons that I've created with some buttons of your own. This is very, very customizable. So let's take a look at what we've got going on here. This self-service portal is a portal that a user might open up whenever they're having problems, and we've got a few different options here. The user can reset their password, they can map a network drive, they can reclaim disk space if they were starting to run low on hard drive space, or they could request support, and there's also an exit button. Now, one of the important things that I've done in creating this script is I've baked in some error handling, because we don't want the self-service portal, which is supposed to be the solution to the user's problems, to become yet another problem. So what kind of error handling have I done? Well, let me give you an example. Let's suppose for a moment that I wanted to reset my password. If I were to click on Reset Password right now, I get a pop-up telling me, please enter a username. You'll notice that the PowerShell console did not display an error. And that's because I was able to handle the error before it actually occurred. So I'll click OK. And if I were to go ahead and enter my username and then click Reset Password, now I get a message saying that the password was reset for Brien. Now, you'll notice that the script didn't prompt me for a new password. And the reason for that is very simple. I'm not actually performing a password reset. I didn't want to reset my own password. So there are a couple of lines of code that are commented out. You'll see what that looks like in a few minutes. The next function that we have is map network drive. And the idea here is that oftentimes users have network drives that are mapped to data that they use or perhaps to applications. And sometimes Windows might lose that drive mapping. So rather than the user having to contact the help desk, they could click a map drive button to automatically have that drive mapping restored. Now, if I click map drive, I'm probably going to get an error message. Yeah, and you can see the error right there. And the reason for that is because I'm not mapping to a real path. You can see the command right here, new PS drive, that's the command that you use within PowerShell to map a network drive, dash name, I'm mapping the Z drive, dash root, and then I have a totally fake path, //server/share, and then dash PS provider would be file system, indicating that I want a file system drive. So what else have we got going on here? Well, we have reclaimed disk space, and if I click on this, then that's going to launch a Windows utility that's going to give me the opportunity to choose the disk that I want to clean up and then perform some basic cleanup options on it to try to free up some disk space. I'll go ahead and exit out of that. And then the last thing that we have is request support. And I'm probably going to get an error on this one too because I don't actually have a mail client installed on this machine. So that being the case, let's go ahead and take a look at the code that's associated with this self-service portal. So here we have the code. And the very first line of code loads one of the necessary assemblies. And that assembly is called system.windows.forms. And this brings up an important point. PowerShell is truly a command line interface. But as you just saw with my self-service portal, it can do graphical user interfaces. And when it comes to building a graphical user interface, you have two main choices. You can use Windows Forms, or you can use the Windows Presentation Foundation. Now, in this particular case, I've chosen to use Windows Forms. And the reason for that is building a GUI from Windows Forms tends to be a little bit easier to do. There's more documentation, the process is a bit more straightforward. I just find it easier, so that's what I chose to use. Now, Windows Presentation Foundation is a perfectly viable option, but you would typically want to use Windows Presentation Foundation if you wanted to build a more modern GUI, or if you needed to include advanced GUI functionality, things like animations and that sort of thing. So let's take a look at how the rest of the code works. Here, I'm adding another assembly, system.drawing. Then the next thing that I'm doing is I'm creating a form. Now, when it comes to Windows Forms, a form is really just a window. If I were to go back to my application, you'll notice that all of these buttons exist within a window, and that window is the form. Let me go ahead and slide this off to the side right here. So you can see that we're creating a form as a new object of type system.windows.forms.form, and I'm calling the form self-service portal. And if you look at the very top right here where my mouse pointer is, you can see that we have the word self-service portal. That's where that came from. Then we're defining the size of the form, in this case 400 pixels by 350 pixels. I'm setting the background to white, and I'm placing this at the center of the screen. So that's how we create a form. Now, once our form has been created, the next step in the process is to create all of the various GUI elements that we're going to use. So in this case, we've got a few different GUI elements that we're using. We have some labels, which a label is just a mechanism that lets you put a string of text on the screen. So we have a label for the word username right here. We have a status label. You can see right here a service request sent. That's done by way of a status label. Then we have some buttons. So I have a password reset button, a map drive button, a request support button, a reclaim disk space button, and an exit button. And then I also have a text box right here next to the username field. So those are the GUI elements. And the way that this works is that we define the GUI element, we set attributes on the GUI element, and then we add the GUI element to the form. So let's take a look at how this works. If you look right here, we're creating a GUI element called user label, and that's the word username right here. So we're creating a new object of type system.windows.forms.label. We're setting the text to username, and indeed you can see the word username right here. We're defining the location where it appears on the screen, and the location is 20 pixels to the right and 20 pixels from the top of the screen. And so you can see that username does appear in the upper left corner, 20 pixels from the top and 20 pixels from the left. Then we're setting the label size, and the label is 100 pixels wide by 20 pixels high. And we're probably not using all of that space, but we could. And then the very last thing that we're doing is we have $form, which is the variable name associated with the form that we created, .controls.add, so we're adding to the form, and then $userlabel. $userlabel is the name of the label object that we've created. So we're adding the label object to the form. And even though I'm doing this on a label object, the process works in exactly the same way for all of the other graphical elements, whether we're adding a button or a text box or something else. You create the object associated with that, you define the attributes that you want to use, and then you add the object to the form. You can see that we're doing exactly the same thing right here for the text box. The only difference is that this time, instead of creating a label object, we're creating a text box object. So once again, we're setting the location, we're setting the size, and then we're adding the text box to the form. And we're doing exactly the same thing with all of the other GUI objects that we're creating. So now that I've shown you how the GUI works, I want to show you how the button click actions and some of the error handling work. So let me go ahead and click back over to my script, and I'm going to scroll down, and here's where we start defining the buttons. Now, creating a button is exactly like creating any other GUI object. We begin by creating an object. In this case, that object is of type system.windows.forms.button. Then we set the attributes for that object. So we're setting the text that appears on the button, we're defining the button's location, its size, and its color. And then we're adding a button click action. So we have reset password button dot add click. So anything that appears between here and here are going to be instructions that are going to be executed if someone clicks on this particular button. So what are we doing? Well, as you'll recall, I mentioned before that the reset password button wasn't actually performing a password reset, that I had a couple of commands commented out. So let's take a look at what's going on. The first thing that we have is if dash not dash username. So we're checking to see if the username field has been populated or not. So if the user has not entered a username into the username field, then we're going to execute this block of code right here. And this is going to cause PowerShell to display a message box, and it's going to show the phrase, please enter a username. You saw what that looked like earlier. If I were to get rid of my name right here and click reset password, I would get that message box. This is the code that's doing that. So assuming that a username has been entered, we skip all of this, and then we go down here. So the first thing that we have is a comment that if you're performing an Active Directory password reset, you're going to need the RSAT or the Active Directory module. And then here's the PowerShell commandlet that would actually be used for a password reset. It's set AD account password. But we're not actually resetting the password because this entire command has been commented out. And the pound sign indicates a comment. So anything appearing after a pound sign is treated as a comment. So what we're doing then is we're updating the status label.txt to display the phrase password reset for a username. If an error had occurred, we would execute the catch and we would display a different string of text, error resetting password. Now there's two things going on here that I want to show you. The first is the try and catch. Here we have try, here we have catch. So in PowerShell, try gives you the opportunity to try a block of code and see if it's going to produce an error. So we're trying all of this to see if an error occurs. If an error doesn't occur, then the code is allowed to run. If an error does occur, then we're going to execute the catch. And the catch is everything between these two brackets. So we're updating the status label. Now, this leads to the other thing that I wanted to explain. Let me go ahead and scroll back up to where I was defining my GUI objects. Here we have a GUI object for status label. And this is exactly like the username label that I showed you earlier. So we create the label, and we're creating a new object of type system.windows.forms.label. Next, we set some attributes for the label. And the attributes that we're setting are .text, and we're setting .text equal to nothing. So there's not initially going to be any text associated with that label. Then we're setting the location. And then I'm using an attribute called autosize, and I'm setting that to true. And this just lets PowerShell automatically adjust the size of the label just so that I don't have to guess at how big it needs to be. And then we're adding the label object to the form. So what I wanted to show you is that this label object doesn't initially have any text associated with it. But if I go back to the password reset button, you'll notice that we're updating statusLabel.txt, and we're providing a message to appear as the status label. So the reason I wanted to show this to you is to underscore the idea that you can modify the attributes that are associated with a GUI object anytime within your script. You're not stuck with those attributes after you define them. You can change them anytime that you want. So if you want to change what a label says, all you have to do is call that object, in this case status label, add the text attribute .text, and then set that equal to whatever it is that you want it to say. So let's go ahead and scroll down some more. And we've got a few other buttons. We have the map network drive button. And I mentioned earlier that this wasn't pointing to a real network share, but the command that I'm using for a drive mapping is new ps drive dash name, and then I'm calling it z, that's going to be the z drive, dash root, and then here's the file path, //server/share, and then ps provider is file system. And so if this succeeds, we'll get a message in the status label that says mapped z to server/share. And if the command fails, then the status label will be updated to say error mapping network drive. Let me scroll down a little bit more. And here we have the button that's used to reclaim some disk space. So the text on the button is reclaim disk space. And with the click action, our try is going to be start process. So I'm starting a new process. And then cleanmanager.exe, that's a built-in Windows utility. Dash argument list low disk. So I'm going to run the cleanup manager in low disk space mode. And then I'm setting the status label text equal to system cleanup started. And if an error occurred, then I would change that status label to say cleanup failed. So the next thing that we have is the button used to request support. And this button is constructed in exactly the same way as the other buttons. Here though, we're doing something a little bit different. We're setting a variable for to, and then subject, and body, and we're constructing an email message using those variables. Then I'm using the command send mail message to send that message. Now, as I mentioned earlier, this isn't actually going to work because I don't have direct access to a mail server. The other problem with this technique is that Microsoft no longer supports it. Let me show you what I mean. So here we have Microsoft support page for the send mail message commandlet. And if I scroll down, you can see a warning message, and it says the send mail message commandlet is obsolete. This commandlet doesn't guarantee secure connections to SMTP servers. While there is no immediate replacement available in PowerShell, we recommend that you do not use send mail message. I wanted to point this out because this is something you probably shouldn't be using in production. Even so, Microsoft's not saying that you can't use it, just that there are risks associated with using it. The only reason why I included send mail message in my script is just because I wanted to illustrate a bit of diversity. Each one of the buttons that I've created does something a little bit different. Because if I scroll back up, the first button that I've created, reset password, calls an Active Directory related commandlet, set AD account password. The second button maps a network drive and it uses a native PowerShell commandlet, new PS drive. The third one calls a native Windows tool. So we're starting a process called clean manager and we're providing some arguments. And then the fourth button initiates the send mail message commandlet. So each one of our buttons is doing something a little bit different as a part of its click action. And then finally we have the exit button. And if the exit button is clicked, then what we're doing is closing the form. And then the very last line of code in the script is $form.showDialogOutNull. And this is what causes the form to be displayed on the screen. Now there's one more thing that I want to quickly mention before I wrap up this video. In order to launch the self-service portal, I had to open up PowerShell and navigate to my scripts folder and then launch the portal.ps1 script, as you can see right here. And it's probably a bit much to expect your end users to do this. So instead, what I would recommend doing is going out to GitHub and downloading ps2exe. ps2exe is a utility that you can use to take a PowerShell script and compile it into an executable. So that way, you can create a desktop icon for your users. They double-click on that icon, it launches the executable that you've created, and puts them directly into the self-service portal that you've built. So that's how you go about building a self-service portal in a PowerShell environment. I'm Brien Posey. Thanks for watching.